Welcome back, and please join our conversation on social media platforms using the hashtag The Modise Network. My guest is the leader of the DA, Mmusi Maimane, who's talking to us from our Cape Town studios. And Tata Maimane, let me pick up the from the older issues that we discussed earlier on and suggest this to you. Do you think the time has arrived in South Africa for the constitution to be amended so that representatives can be elected directly, given what we know now about the campaigns and the internal fights that go on within political parties?
Abratim, I always have looked at the Van Zyl Slabbert report that looked at the constituency-based system as a way forward to electing public representatives. And I support that view because ultimately it would break South Africa into constituencies so that our members of parliament can be elected directly. And secondly, we could have a proportion of at least 100 MPs who would then, in that instance, represent the diversity of our nation. And lastly, ensure that we have a direct election of a president. That the time for that has been long overdue, because our consensus was such that a proportional representative system served our country in being able to bring all citizens together. Now, the next phase that we're at is about building constitutional democracy that has accountability. So that must be the next phase. But ultimately, even beyond that phase, you want to ensure that institutions of government are able to work. Because democracy isn't just voting in a person. It's about making sure that the institutions that govern democracy also work. So you also want a functioning parliament. You want a functioning prosecutorial system, judiciary, so that accountability can still be effected.
Which then suggests that the DA is open to the amendment of the constitution, for instance, for the benefit of the broader South African majority, because the view is held that the DA is opposed to the amendment of Section 25, the property clause of the constitution, because it's averse to amending the constitution. Would you be open to that then, that the constitution be amended in order for expropriation without compensation, expropriation of land without compensation to take place?
But Tim, the constitution of the Republic of South Africa has been amended a number of times, and we've made additions to that. So it's not just to say that it's a static document, it's a living document. But you can't amend for the sake of just amending. And when somebody says to me, against the report of someone like President Kgalema Motlanthe in the high-level panel report, says that to be able to address this question of land and ensure that land reform and land restitution in fact take place, you don't need a constitutional amendment, then it sounds a bit strange when a political party starts there. That's not our issue. Our issue is, as President Motlanthe has already articulated, it's about corruption, it's about political will, and it's about the financial master to be able to do so. So our opposition to the amending of Section 25 is that it will adversely impact the very South Africans we're trying to benefit. It will ensure that, in fact, the property prices decline and ultimately collapse our economy if you carry on. You can't ask people to come and invest in a country and then in the same breath saying to you, we can't guarantee you private property rights. It is simply wrong to be able to take that approach. We simply say we must enhance land reform and land restitution, and it can be done within the current constitutional framework. And we can ensure that we grow our economy so that more South Africans are landowners, not less, and that all citizens are entitled to be able to own land, invest in it, and grow our economy. So this is not a constitutional matter. The two matters are completely separate.
Well, talking about the economy, the president himself has admitted that the South African economy is in a crisis. And of course, ordinary folk are feeling the effects thereof, with increasing unemployment rate in the country and a negligible or no growth at all. And of course, the population is growing in the meantime. What should South Africa, firstly, what's your take of that statement that we're in a crisis? And two, how do we get out of this situation?
Absolutely, Bratim, because 10.2 million people who are unemployed or cannot find work. This is a crisis. It's a crisis for any nation. And it's a crisis born out of the fact that ideologically you've got two contesting visions. The first vision is that of a large state and the nationalization of everything. Nationalizing healthcare, nationalizing energy, nationalizing the Reserve Bank, nationalizing people's pension funds. It's an ANC ideological box. And I'm saying to it, it has brought the results that we've got here today. It's put us in a fiscal crisis where we're running out of money, and it's ensured that ultimately as a country, we now have to look at other alternatives as to how we can sustain ourselves. I think we need to look at a change from that. And this is our proposal, is that we need to find reforms. The most immediate reform is what we do around the reforms of state-owned enterprises, the biggest of those being Eskom. It is going to be crucial is that if we're going to grow this economy, we need reliable energy, but we need diverse energy. We need to allow independent power producers to come online. We need to make sure that we split Eskom into two companies, one for distribution and the other for build. We can ensure that actually municipalities who are capable are able to purchase energy directly. That's about stabilizing energy in that sector, but we need to reform other state-owned enterprises and create better partnerships with the private sector. Secondly, we need to take a differing view on what we do around cities. We need city-led economic development. City-led economic development will ensure that we stimulate micro-enterprise so that small businesses can mushroom and that more people are able to find work. Furthermore, we need to look at other key sectors and use tax as a stimulus so that more jobs can be created. So when you look at manufacturing, can we reduce corporate tax so that more people are able to invest in that sector and that we can be able to create jobs? How do we adjudicate visas on point of arrival so that tourism is an industry that we can grow? How do we adjudicate on spectrum so that more investment can be done in our ICT sector so that we can create jobs of the future? So, and then lastly, how do we look at agriculture as a job enabler so that we can secure property rights so that farming can continue and that more jobs can be created there? The big decisions we have to make pertain to policy and picking policy that says in how do we stimulate an economy so that more private sector players and citizens are able to create wealth. If we don't make tough decisions and tough calls, I'm afraid we can't be married to the dogma of a state-led economic development. We need to move away from it and say to ourselves, let's restructure the South African economy, bring the reforms so that ultimately we can create the requisite jobs that are needed.
But here's the point then. In the context of the economic crisis that the president admits we are in now, the ANC says, well, we actually want to improve the healthcare system of South Africa, and that's why we are now fast-tracking the introduction of the national health insurance. And I know you say that this is a matter that, if needs be, will have to be taken to the courts. What is it that you are opposed to when it comes to the NHI?
Well, Bratim, all of us as South Africans agree that we must provide universal health care for citizens. And all of us would agree about the fact that the current model is simply unsustainable in making sure that citizens, all of them across the board, get health care. The difficulty here is that national health insurance has already been piloted at an exorbitant cost and has shown to have failed. Because the public sector simply does not have all the capability to be able to deliver the quality of healthcare. And secondly, if you then nationalize healthcare, you shift all resources to national government, undermine the province's ability to be able to deliver on healthcare. And that's the constitutional question that we are raising in Parliament. So to me, the future of healthcare pertains to simply saying, how do we take the tax benefit that was derived when people make contributions elsewhere and then regain them back through tax, that we can put them into the fiscus, allow for citizens at a primary healthcare level to be able to gain access to both public and private sector health institutions so that we can give at a primary healthcare, accessible healthcare and universal healthcare across the board, stimulate what is happening in the private sector so that more people have got options, so that if they choose at secondary and tertiary level to be able to do that, they can still depend on their private resources to do that. Because if you then give them that option, it means you don't have to burden the state as the sole provider of healthcare to the detriment of all the other services that you've got. So to us, it's about making sure citizens have got choice, it is financially viable, and that we can provide universal health care. And the ANC's model of national health insurance has already been in the pilot phase shown to fail, and its cost is simply unaffordable. And nobody sitting here today can tell you how much it's going to cost, because they know, as much as the next person, is that it will make the nuclear build that Jacob Zuma was looking at look like a picnic when national health insurance is put in full play.
Well, let's look at the safety of the citizens situation, right? In the Western Cape, where the DA is government, the army had to be called in to maintain law and order and provide some safety levels there. And in Johannesburg, we saw foreign nationals attack the police here. And, you know, it's a variety of issues that are facing South Africa at the moment. But national government, the provincial competencies, the local government competencies seem to be at the center of the inability of the state to protect and provide safety to citizens. What are your views?
Well, and there again, Ebratim, we've got to be able to bring a policing as a function to become a much better, a more provincial competence. We've got the national SELPs, which means that often intelligence doesn't sit on the ground. So even though you might know who the criminals are, often the provincial policing is not given enough ability to fight those criminals because it's all controlled nationally. I'm saying if you bring it to the province, you can merge where there are metros, a much bigger force between Metro Police and South African Police at a provincial level to fight crime as a start, so that you are much better and you can increase the size of the force without having to spend more money. Because our next crisis as to why we can't fight crime is the fact that when you look at police to citizen ratio, the average internationally must be between 200 and 400. In other communities where crime is a hotspot, so if you go to Nyanga, that proportion is 1:600. If you come to Dobsonville, my neck of the woods, that number is 1:1200. So it's obvious that policeman is not going to be able to fight and keep up with crime. So you must bring the powers of policing down to the province, merge them with the Metro Police, and so we become much more effective. Furthermore, the capacity of police is undermined by the lack of equipment, by the lack of training. So you find detectives are not well trained. Vehicles that the police have are not effective in fighting crime. So criminals are much more capacitated in certain syndicate areas to fight crime. And ultimately, you need specialization. That's why it's important to bring it down to provinces, because there is a unique composition of crime in different communities. You are correct. So in the Western Cape, it might very well be a gang-related problem. In Gauteng, it might very well be a different problem as it would be in KZN or the Eastern Cape. The better we bring policing closer to the citizens, the more intelligent we can become about fighting crime.
Well, many issues that I wanted to raise with you, Dr. Mmusi Maimane, but thank you nevertheless for having given us your time and sharing your thoughts with us on some of these big issues facing our nation today. Thank you. And that was Mmusi Maimane, leader of the DA.
Much appreciated, brother.
And after the break, I will be talking to musical legend Kaifa Semenya.